there, my name's Vince from mymatevince.com, and in this video today I'm going to be installing SIM cards in these five phones. Now we're going to have a variety of styles going from the oldest to the newest, and we're going to be using the nano, micro and a standard SIM card and also a SIM removal tool. So hopefully by watching these five phones, one of them will be similar to you.
Hey there, it's Des with T-Mobile, and today we're checking out the new Moxie Tablet 2. This affordable tablet features a bright display, dual cameras, and a reliable battery. And best of all, it rocks T-Mobile's nationwide network. The Moxie Tablet 2 has an 8-inch HD Plus display, great for on-the-go entertainment. Its 3.5mm jack is here for your wired headphones. And if you prefer to go wireless, the Moxie is paired with Bluetooth 5 on-the-go entertainment. Its 3.5mm jack is here for your wired headphones. And if you prefer to go wireless, the Moxie has you covered with Bluetooth 5.0. Video chatting and taking great photos or videos can be done complements of its dual 5-megapixel cameras, located on both the front and back of the tablet. Now inside the Moxie.
Getting a little boy from an orphanage in Nova Scotia, and he's coming in on the afternoon.
Oh, how do, Matthew?
Is the afternoon train due soon?
She's waiting for you on the platform.
She?
My name is Anne Shirley. Anne spelled with me.
It's a girl.
I can see that. Where's the boy?
There weren't any. Just her.
We have absolutely no use for a girl.
You don't want me to...
Lil Easy, what's up?
Most definitely good, man. Good, man.
Good long to see time. You again.
Oh, yeah. Long time.
It's been some years.
Yeah.
Before Vlad TV.
Really?
DVD.
I know. I just tripped off that when I'm walking up. I said, wow.
So let's start from the beginning. Your dad is Easy.
Uh-huh.
You're the oldest child?
Yes, most definitely.
Okay. Yeah. You have, there's 10 brothers and sisters total?
Yeah, well, the recent finding of one more, so I guess he hit 11.
Oh, we hit 11?
Yeah.
There was a new kid that popped up.
Yeah.
It was a boy or girl?
Boy. About okay. my age.
About your age?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Well, not too far from me. Name's Eric.
Name Eric Hall.
Really?
Yeah. Boy, Easy.
It's funny, as he just actually left the day you hit me, actually, the day he was leaving. And I got the text to come do the interview. And we just did a little family thing. He went through the whole process of a blood test, you know what I mean? Oh. And he contacted me 8 years ago, I would say, when I was working at Ruthless Records. I remember the day like it was yesterday. And I looked at his picture and was like, wow, his name said Eric Wright. So, you know, it was a long story. You know, his mom kind of just vanished off, went to Memphis, you know what I mean? So he lives in Memphis. You know, he's originally from Inglewood. So just vanished off when he was young. And he just wanted to reach out. He's a truck driver. Just wanted to reach out to before his mom passed away to get closure to his family. So it was kind of touching, you know what I mean? And it's cool, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? It just kind of, you know, was got to get that brother vibe real quick, you know what I mean?
When the girls outside, little bitch, you better be ready. When the guys outside, little bitch, you better be ready. When the stars align, little bitch, you better be ready. I want to take my time, little bitch, you know I'm ready. I want it right now, little bitch, you know I'm ready. I'm black the same color as cranberry. You come on by my gang, it's her man. Them niggas not no thugs, they some fans. I'm playing with them birds like I'm Larry. We park right by the curb, they can't tell me. I'm smoking on the rush, you can smell it. This bag I got all orange, nice and fancy. My bitch, she says she want me, niggas tell me. We call them on the block, we talk to smell it. Yeah, we push up to your...
Yeah, the complete absence of vibration is amazing. It's like you're sitting in a chair and the rest of the world is moving past you, but you're sitting still, you know?
I love it. I'm glad that you appreciate that. There are a lot of people that are scared of that, and if you say this, I hope that maybe you give to Electric a shot.
I mean, I think if you're a guy under 40 and you grew up with Star Wars and all those kind of things, this kind of sound and feel really, you really connect with it because it was the sound of power and excitement when you were a kid.
Welcome to the episode of Jay Leno Drive. Today's something, well, a little bit different, you know. The world's going electric. I have two Energica motorcycles here from Italy. And boy, these look like Italian motorcycles. These are the most beautiful electric bikes I've seen. And they contain the most powerful battery of any electric motorcycle, at least currently on the market, 2023. You know, it's funny. You look at them. I didn't realize at first that they're electric. And wait a minute. There's no exhaust pipe here. You got to keep an open mind. You know, it's so funny. Bikers are the most conservative people. But electric, I just get mad and they get all upset and loud pipes save lives and all that kind of stuff. But you got Harley making the live wire, and this is the future. You'll always have, I think, ice bikes and some electric bikes. I have to say, I've been riding this the last couple of days. You know, I'm sorry, guys. I don't mean to abandon it, but not that I would ever abandon my Vincent and my Bruce Superiors and my Harley, but they're getting around town pretty quick, because the nice thing about this is, performance-wise, it doesn't feel like an electric bike. I mean, we tend to think of electric bikes as being slower. It's not. This is 171 horsepower. Incredible torque. Just the idea of going down the road, just kind of a whooshing noise, of, you know, the air going past your head. It's pretty amazing. We have two gentlemen here that explain the whole thing to us here. As I said, this is sort of the street fighter model. This is the classic. Here's my mistake. Whenever I get bikes, I fall in love with the low bars, and then I ride for a couple hours. I go, you know, I want to get a bike with just normal size handlebars so I can drive around town without my back killing at the end of the day. I mean, I've got so many cafe racer bikes. I got to go with the street fighter bike, and this is the one I've been driving, or riding, rather. and it's been pretty incredible. You got a range of a little bit over 100 miles. Charges up pretty quickly. You've got a fast charger, a DC, and of course you have the AC. I mean, it's not a light bike. It's about 600 pounds approximately, but it carries its weight pretty low. You know, I've ridden a lot of electric bikes. I just feel like all the weight is up here. Not so much with this one. Let's bring in two men who, well, they're the heart and soul of this company, at least here in America. Lawrence and Stefano. Come on in, guys. Now, you're the CEO.
Yes, of course.
I'm sorry for everybody for the accent, but this is how it sounds. No, no, you and my grandfather hit it off good. he's from Naples, I believe. So very good. Well, you know, you can't beat Italian style. And this is just such a beautiful bike. Because the biggest thing a lot of people have electric bikes is they don't look like motorcycles. This looks like a motorcycle. Anybody seeing this wouldn't even realize it was electric. Hey, wait a minute, there's no exhaust pipe. So tell us basically what we have here, John. We have the most powerful battery. I think this is the most powerful electric bike on the market currently, is that correct?
As far as a road bike is concerned, yes.
Yeah. So where do we begin? How long has this company been around? It's fairly new to America. I know you guys have been in Europe for a number of years.
And there is also a nice story that we met you. It was a coincidental meeting here in L.A. in the Rock Store in 2014.
Oh, that's right.
I shared two pictures before about that. And we were doing, you know, the first demo tour, and you were driving a car. We saw you. We invited you to have a ride, and you invited us to contact you back because we were too young. Nice bike, but hey, you establish a business, start selling, and then contact you back. There we are.
Well, I'm glad you came back because it's amazing because electric vehicles have grown leaps and bounds since 14.
For sure.
14, and that's like the 1940s in terms of internal combustion. That's how quickly it's moving. And what was the range in those days?
Maybe six.
By far our best market for all the other EV manufacturers. And finally, I'm glad to say that we have bikes available for test ride in our dealers, the dealer network here in the USA. It is expanding, and this is possible thanks to the support of iDynamics.
Yeah.
It is an American company, and their mission is to accelerating the adoption of electric vehicles. And they have a pretty solid collection of electric vehicle technologies, including not just vehicles or charging station, but also electric tractor. That will be something interesting to explore.
I notice also that the RPM kind of matches a gas engine in the sense that 70 miles an hour is about 4,000 RPM. Is that deliberate or just coincidental?
I can say coincidental. By the way, consider that the max RPM of this platform is around 12,000 RPM.
Right.
With Xperia, we can be a little bit higher, around 13,000. But at the end, you know, the general chart of the torque and the power is the typical one of an electric vehicle. So you have a lot of torque, instant torque at the beginning, and the power ramp up. After that, of course, the power will become more, flat, and the torque start to slow down. Typical path of every electric vehicle.
I love how linear it is. It's not herky-jerky on the throttle. You can roll it on or roll off. If you open you open the throttle quickly, it doesn't stumble. It's very good.
I'm glad you like it. You sound like a converted rider. And just being the boring engineer, inside your throttle, there is a potentiometer. So this is how it works. And of course, the VCU does the magic, giving you a warm throttle and motorcycle experience. And this is how it works.
Yeah, the fun thing is with a vehicle like this, people who might not ever want a motorcycle would be intrigued by an electric, you know?
Look, yes, I totally agree. From my side, at the end, this is not probably an entry-level bike or the bike that you suggest to a guy who has, or a girl who has just got their motorcycle license. It's equivalent to a 1,000cc sport bike. So I understand that it's easy, but you know, you have also a huge responsibility with all this torque.
But the nice thing is, if you choose not to use this all the power, you don't have to. It's never intimidating.
Yes. Correct. You are absolutely right. And but it's like when you deal with that dog, right? It's not the dog bad per se, but it's the human factor. I'm curious. Do you prefer silent electric or this sound is better for you?
I just don't want anything boring. I like one extreme or the other. I like the absence of noise, and then I like noise. I don't want something that's annoying in the middle. You know what I mean?
You're right. That's
the coronavirus pandemic is having a huge impact on the restaurant business, including fast food giants like McDonald's. The company announced this week that global sales were down nearly 24% last quarter. McDonald's plans to close about 200 stores here in the U.S., and it just unveiled new initiatives to tackle the pandemic and racial injustice, including measures to address hiring bias. Only on CBS This Morning, President and CEO Chris Kempczinski joins us from McDonald's global headquarters in Chicago. Mr. Kempczinski, thanks for being with us, and thanks for joining us. I wanted to ask you to start off by explaining what the new initiatives are.
What we just announced yesterday to our entire system, it was 12,000 people joined us across 93 countries, was refreshing our company values. These are values that started with Ray Kroc 65 years ago, and it's something I believe very passionately about as a leader. And so we announced a set of values, five values, one of which, as you mentioned in the opening, was about diversity and inclusion. So that's what we announced yesterday.
So part of the these ideas.
I'm weak.
The coronavirus pandemic is having a huge impact on the restaurant business, including fast food giants like McDonald's. The company announced this week that global sales were down nearly 24% last quarter. McDonald's plans to close about 200 stores here in the U.S., and it just unveiled new initiatives to tackle the pandemic and racial injustice, including measures to address hiring bias. Only on CBS This Morning, President and CEO Chris Kempczinski joins us from McDonald's global headquarters in Chicago. Mr. Kempczinski, thanks for being with us, and thanks for joining us. I wanted to ask you to start off by explaining what the new initiatives are.
We just announced yesterday to our entire system, it was 12,000 people joined us across 93 countries, was refreshing our company values. These are values that started with Ray Kroc 65 years ago, and it's something I believe very passionately about as a leader. And so we announced a set of values, five values, one of which, as you mentioned in the opening, was around diversity and inclusion. So that's what we announced yesterday.
So part of the these ideas came from your own experience on a global listening tour of McDonald's workers. What did you hear that surprised you?
I think I don't know if it was a surprise so much as just a reaffirmation about how important it is for us to be talking about values, whether it was down to the crew person all the way up to my senior team. There's a strong desire for us to be talking about values because it's a common vocabulary. It's something that across the globe, we have 2 million people that work in the McDonald's system. When we talk about values, it sets expectations and it ensures that all of us are living up to those. So I think just for me, what I heard in the listening tour was just a reminder about how important it is for us to continue to reinforce the values because it's what makes McDonald's such a special company.
What specifically will you try to change, and how will you ensure that it actually happens?
I think across all of the values, for me, what we're trying to do is just make it more part of how we're operating on a day-to-day basis. So one of the values is about keeping our people in our...
I
the emancipator, and the architect of rock and roll, with hits like Tutti Frutti, Long Tall Sally, Rip It Up, Lucille, and Good Golly Miss Molly, he became a rock and roll legend. Will you please welcome the very talented and always outrageous Little Richard. Originator, the emancipator, or the architect of rock and roll?
I was all three. Before me, that was nothing.
I know.
Toilet paper. Shut up.
Now, whose idea? Because you're very toned down, but even toned down, there's still a real Little Richard look.
Yeah.
Who figured out? You were so outrageous. The first time I saw it, I said, don't take, what's that? You know, who's that? What's that? Because you wore, go ahead.
I wore everything. I wore my mother's curtains, the sheets, the pillowcase, whatever. I just wanted to be famous and coming from a little town in Macon, Georgia. My mother had 12 children, and I was the third child. And I just wanted some attention. And I decided that I put on some makeup on my face. My dad liked to kill me. I decided that I would take my mother's dresses and just put them all around my shoulders and make shows. I was beautiful though.
Oh, I know.
Very gorgeous.
But you were the first to do that.
Now, I was the first.
Prince dresses up.
That's right. Prince really looked like I used to look exactly, but he really hates to admit it. Prince, I'm a perfect Prince, darling.
What was the most outrageous thing you ever wore on stage? Remember?
Yeah.
Or your favorite?
My favorite outfit was in Vegas when I was in Margaret and I had a gold outfit that I wore, green and gold shoes, and I walked on a green and gold carpet, and the bodyguards would lift me out of the car. I love that. And then Liberace started doing right after that. Yeah.
Do you miss that? You're so toned down.
Yes, I miss it because I still like to look good. You know, as I get older, I really want to look good.
Yeah.
When I get up in the morning and see something over here, something down there, I get mad.
Have you fixed yourself yet?
I'm planning on. I'm trying to find the man that Michael had. I can't find him.
The
one that Michael Jackson
used. Oh, Dr. Hockman.
Oh, that's him?
Yeah, speak to me later.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. That's money. That's fucking money.
You know, now, you also did something very brave. You were the first performer, I think, ever to come out and say, I am a homosexual.
Yes, and everybody got mad with me for saying that. You know, I didn't mind telling the world that I was gay. I was gay. And it's nice to be happy.
It sure is.
I was happy, and I wanted the world to know that I was happy. And I wasn't ashamed. I had been that way all my life, and I didn't know nothing else but that. And so I told everybody that I am gay. I am the originator. I think I was the first one of them, too.
That God made Adam to be with Eve, not Steve, so I had to cut back.
I am done.
our first guest paved the way for people like Elvis Presley, the Beatles, Michael Jackson, NBC.
When a disc jockey by the name of Alan Freed coined the phrase rock and roll, and there was no entertainer more a part of that era than this afternoon's guest. His hard-driving style and his flamboyancy created an awful lot of hits. Miss Molly, and the list goes on. Would you please welcome Little Richard?
Well, good afternoon, Little Richard, and welcome to People Are Talking.
Glad to be here.
Nice to have you here. Your life has been so dramatic. Did you ever think as a small boy in Macon, Georgia, that you were going to be a big rock and roll star?
I wanted to be, but I couldn't think about it because there wasn't nothing that big in my hometown. The biggest thing in my hometown was the jailhouse. I never thought that I would be famous. I always wanted to be famous. You know, when the teacher would say, ask me what you want to be. She said, school teacher. John, what you going to be? He said, mortician. So Richard, what you want to be after a movie star? She said, oh, shut your mouth. She says, no stars ever left out of this place. So I wanted to leave because I really wanted to shine. So I was singing Tutti Frutti, you know, in Macon when I was a little boy. I was saying, wop, bop, loo, bop, a lop, bam, boom, but there was nobody boom for me. But I just kept on. I was singing Tutti Frutti when I was a little boy, slipping on the slide, and I was singing that when I was a little boy.
So when you ran away, it was Dr. Hudson's
medicine show, yes.
You knew you wanted to be a big star.
Yeah, but I didn't see that when I was with Dr. Hudson because there wasn't ever snake oil.
Yeah.
And Dr. Hudson would go to the different cities and he would tell these black people that this medicine was good for everything. Rheumatism, arthritis, or whatever you had, and they was buying it. And I found out that he was the snake. The oil wasn't the snake. He was taking their money. And then I left there and I went with a show called Sugarfoot Sam from Alabama. And I started singing there. Then I left there and joined the circus, King Brother Circus. And I thought that they was going to put me on the stage, and they put me in the kitchen, so I had to leave there because I had done enough dishwashing in my home because I didn't want to wash no more dishes. So I left there. Then I had to come back to Macon, and I started washing dishes at the Greyhound bus station. I was making $15 a week, working 12 hours a day. Lloyd Price came to my hometown. He had our Lord and Miss Claudie. And I told him, I said, you know, I can sing better than you. And so he didn't like that. So he said, why don't you send a tape to Specialty Records? So I made this tape to send to Specialty Records. And they got back in touch with me 1 year later, and I went to New Orleans, and they wanted me to sound like Ray Charles and B.B. King. And so I was singing all these low-down blues, and when the session was over, I started to play the piano. They didn't know that I played piano. I was playing the piano and singing wop bop loo bop bop bam boom, but it wasn't Tutti Frutti or Rudy, it was Tutti Frutti or something else. So they got the girl to clean it up and put, I got a gal named Sue, she knows what to do. I got a gal named Daisy, she almost drive me crazy, so we had to change it around, you know, but it became an instant hit, and I got so big that the white girls and the white guys were screaming over me, so they threw Elvis Presley on me to stop that. I was getting too big, you know, because I was with R.C. Victor before Elvis. I was recording for them in 1951. The black artist was on Camden. Then Pat Boone covered me with Tutti Frutti.
And when you say covered, you mean he made
he recorded the same song of my music that I've written. The white kids would buy his Tutti Frutti and put it on the dresser. They would get my Tutti Frutti and put it in the drawer. So their mother wouldn't know they had mine. We was in the same room but different locations.
They were really worried about young white girls just
screaming
over you.
That's the reason I started wearing makeup. I started wearing eyelashes because that was my only way out. In Georgia, I was a threat because I was one of the few black artists. When I came on the scene, it was Michael and Boy George and David Bowie is doing today that I started on sequins and beads and mirrors and glass. I wore everything they had in the house. Chandeliers, I hang them on my head.
Nobody caught that.
So that in New Orleans at a studio called Cosmo Studio
Recording Studio. Yeah. Because Tutti Frutti was your first.
That's my first.
That video. Was by accident.
That was by accident.
So when you went out to Hollywood and you went into that recording studio, yeah. Because Tutti Frutti was your first.
That's
video.
My first.
That video. Was by accident.
That was by accident, yes. I had a little Chrysler. My mother paid $200 for it. I thought it was a big, and we paid $900 for a house. You know, I thought we was rich, you know. That was $1,100. That was a lot of money to me in those days. And so I went to New Orleans at Cosmo Studio, and I was just playing the piano. And when I was doing this, woo, they get my voice ready for my son. Go, woo. So when I would do that, they just had a fit, you know. And so when the music came out, the white kids really went for me in a big way. They still do. You know, 98% of my audience is white. And I would go to Madison Square Garden. I would have 35,000 people. I would have 20 black people. James Brown would come and have 35,000 black and 20 white people. It was just the opposite. You know, the white kids have always loved me. And then the black kids, my audience was black at first. It was total black, and you would have white spectators upstairs. But Tutti Frutti, Good Golly Miss Molly, Long Tall Sally, Sitting on the Side of Lucille, Jenny, The Girl Can't Help It, Ribbon Up Ready Teddy. Got a gal named Sue, she knows what to do. I got a gal named Daisy, she almost drive me crazy. So we had to change it around, you know, but it became an instant.
This basement would have to get to him without this nigga on stage.
Down in Houston, maybe they can work it out, because I know every time I go out of the house, I'm going to have some kind of hassle with somebody, you know. I give you a concrete example, an anecdote, okay, instead of theory, an anecdote, something that happened to me. I've been trading at this coffee place on Telegraph Avenue in Berkeley for about 15 years. People were very courteous to me. I went in there with another black person, a black man, and I thought they were going to call a riot squad or something, you know what I mean? Because two black men constitute a mob, I guess. That goes back to slavery. Mm-hmm. So I think there's some hostility and conflict between black men and men of other backgrounds in this country. And I think it ought to be worked out in a peaceful manner so that we can avoid some of these conflicts. And I think getting back to education.
You know, but it became an instant hit. And I got so big that the white girls and the white guys were screaming over me. So they threw Elvis Presley on me to stop that. I was getting too big. You know, because I was with R.C. Victor before Elvis. I was recording for them in 1951. The black artist was on Camden. Then Pat Boone covered me with Tutti Frutti.
And when you say covered, you mean he made
he recorded the same song of my music that I'm listening
to.
The white kids would buy his Tutti Frutti and put it on the dresser. They would get my Tutti Frutti and put it in the drawer. So their mother wouldn't know they had mine. We was in the same room but different locations.
Did you tell me that they were really worried about young white girls just
screaming
over you?
That's the reason I started wearing makeup. I started wearing eyelashes because that was my only way out. In Georgia, I was a threat because I was one of the few black artists. When I came on the scene, it was called race music. I was the first black artist to hit the top 40 and become that hero thing, you know, where all the kids are trying to dress like you and look like you. And so when I put on the eyelashes and the makeup and the headband that Prince and Michael and Boy George and David Bowie is doing today, that I started on sequins and beads and mirrors and glass. I wore everything they had in the house. Chandeliers, I hang them on my head.
Bro, this nigga had to get himself out of it. This is a sad story. This shit about to blow up.
We was in the same room but different locations.
They were really worried about young white girls just screaming over you.
That's the reason I started wearing makeup. I started wearing eyelashes because that was my only way out. In Georgia, I was a threat because I was one of the few black artists. When I came on the scene, it was called race music. I was the first black artist to hit the top 40 and become that hero thing, you know, where all the kids are trying to dress like you and look like you. And so when I put on the eyelashes and the makeup and the headband that Prince and Michael and Boy George and David Bowie is doing today, that I started, and the sequins and beads and mirrors and glass, I wore everything they had in the house. Chandeliers, I hang them on my head.
Oh, hell yeah.
That was by accident. By the way, I recorded that in New Orleans at a studio called Cosmo Studio. I had a little Chrysler. My mother paid $200 for it. I thought it was a big, and we paid $900 for a house. You know, I thought we was rich, you know. That was $1,100. That was a lot of money to me in those days. And so I went to New Orleans at Cosmo Studio, and I was just playing the piano. And when I was doing this, woo, they get my voice ready for my son. Go, woo.
What Dave said.
Yeah. Oh, excuse me, Dave, I forgot what you said. Start again.
How does your background in entertaining help you in getting you doing that?
Wow.
Dave, when you get 51, you forget. Like, I forgot that you even said it, but you're all right. It really helps my background in this way. It helps me to reach people. It helps the different promoters to bring me to different cities. So I am an evangelist, and I'm a minister. You know, some people think when you're a preacher, you're supposed to... You don't never smile no more. A little boy saw a horse, and he saw all these Christians walk around like this. He saw a big horse, and he said, Mama, that's a good Christian, the horse. You know, you can smile when you're a Christian. You can be alive. You can be the happiest person in the world because you have some hope. You know that when the Lord comes, you're going back. And if you don't have no hope, you don't know him. It helps me a lot. It makes me a better person. It helps me to understand people and to know that God loves everybody where they stand, and you come to him as you are.
Why did you leave rock and roll the first time?
I became a drug addict. Oh, the first time.
Well, the second time, I mean...
When I came out of show business, I was just teasing, ladies and gentlemen. I don't want the preachers out there to say, oh, I told you he's a hypocrite. hypocrites I found in church, y'all. I found more Christians.
The chapter 6, is called The Night in Question. And you write in the book, now picture this and keep in mind that this is
purely
hypothetical. Yes. Why don't you tell me what might have happened on the night of June 12th, 1994? And let's just walk through the night. The chapter 6, is called The Night in Question. And you write in the book, now picture this and keep in mind that this is
hypothetical.
Yes. Why don't you tell me what might have happened on the night of June 12th, 1994? And let's just walk through the night.
First of all, this is very difficult for me to do this. It's very difficult for me because it's hypothetical. I know and I accept the fact that people are going to feel whatever way they're going to feel. You know, they're going to, you know, some whatever they want to feel. In the book, the hypothetical is
Charlie.
This guy Charlie shows up, the guy who I've recently become friends with, and I don't know why you had been by Nicole's house, but it told me you wouldn't believe what's going on over there. And I remember thinking, well, whatever's going on over there has got to stop, right? So we kind of hooked up together, and, you know, I'm kind of broad-stroking this. We go over, get into Bronco and go over.
Let's just go back and do the details. Where did you park?
I'll go through the detail.
You parked.
Years ago next week, it became a searing American flashpoint, the verdict in the O.J. Simpson murder trial. That courtroom saga was broadcast all day, every day to an audience of millions. But you never heard Simpson speak. He never testified. Tonight, you will see O.J. Simpson in an entirely different way. You will see him forced to answer questions about what happened the night his ex-wife and her friend were killed. From VHS tapes waiting in that underground garage. You'll hear from everyone, from Kris Jenner to OJ's friends, and from those who swore to bring him to some kind of justice. Will what you hear tonight change the way you look at OJ Simpson? Take a look and see.
No.
June 17th, 1994. 20 years ago next week, it became a searing American flashpoint. The verdict in the O.J. Simpson murder trial. That courtroom saga was broadcast all day, every day to an audience of millions. But you never heard Simpson speak. He never testified. Tonight, you will see O.J. Simpson in an entirely different way. You will see him forced to answer questions about what happened the night his ex-wife and her friend were killed. From VHS tapes waiting in that underground garage. You'll hear from everyone, from Kris Jenner to OJ's friend.
Shut up. It doesn't fucking matter. Like a snap. Come here, everybody talk.
Now, who else would Anita. This is OJ's sister.
Baby sister, hi.
Oh, baby sister. What? Say something.
What do you want me to say?
I don't know. This time.
Pardon me? How do I feel today? I'm very happy for OJ and Nicole. Especially, I mean, I'm happy about the wedding.
I'm having a wonderful time, and I'm very happy.
Don't embarrass me. I'm Carmelita.
This is Carmelita. This is OJ's sister.
Baby sister. Hi.
Oh, baby sister. Excuse me, baby sister.
Don't embarrass me.
Say something.
What do you want me to say?
I don't know. Just tell
me.
Oh, baby sister. Excuse me, baby sister.
Don't embarrass me
Say something.
What do you want me to say?
I don't know. Just tell
me.
Excuse me, baby sister.
Don't embarrass me
Say something.